community in which our students live in and the way in which they support each other. So thank you all for being here. So we'll have one, we'll have another thesis defense. One of the privileges I have in my job is I get to read all of the senior theses every year. And one of the things I learned, I get to see things, I think, from this sort of lifeguard chair. I get to see sort of students are always doing different topics, but I see constantly common themes that emerge and things that seem to be disparate, right? And one of the things emerging this year, and we'll see it with Michaela, and we saw it with Alicia the other day, and we certainly saw it with Tori, is this idea that we have a responsibility to always look at the whole person, right? And Michaela certainly will talk about this. I saw a book title once, I don't think I read it, but it was a book title about college teaching, and the title was, Imagine If College Students Were People, right? The idea here is that sometimes we forget, right? That we forget the people which we work with and have a responsibility, that they're whole people, right? They're not simply students, right? Alicia the other day talked about patients, right? They're not simply patients, but they're whole people, right? And we're not treating just diseases, but we're treating people. Tori taught us today that we don't simply have employees, but again, we have people. And Michaela and the second Dr. Narcissi will introduce Michaela. But Michaela's going to talk about whole people too, right? And other sort of aspects of our lives. And here to introduce Michaela is Dr. Narcissi.
So Michaela Meyer is literally the poster child for Regis. And I mean that if you look on our website, there's Michaela's face, right? And really nothing could be more appropriate because who better to represent us than Michaela Meyer? I have been lucky enough to know her for the past 4 years. And apparently she, like many students, found her first year to be a struggle, but I never would have known it. I saw her back then as a student who was engaged, curious, and kind to everyone around her. 4 years later, I know her as an incredible intellect, a passionate advocate for social justice, a tireless perfectionist, and a deeply compassionate human being. I couldn't be prouder to watch her finishing her college career and going on to UPenn for law school. Which she chose because it felt the most like Regis to her. She's going to spend her life as she's spent her time at Regis, fighting for what's right. In between then and now, Michaela took one of my courses, which concluded with Tony Kushner's play, Angels in America. The end of the play has the following line. It isn't easy. It doesn't count if it's easy. It's the hardest thing. Forgiveness, which may be where love and justice finally meet. I believe this closing line is where Michaela's thesis on the rehabilitation of death row inmates begins, with forgiveness as the meeting place between love and justice. And nothing could be more appropriate because Michaela herself is one of the only human beings I know who fully embodies both of these qualities, love and justice. She's going to change the world, and you're here to hear where it all begins.
Thank you.
And that concludes the thesis. I honestly cannot thank Dr. Narcissi and Dr. Michael Bus enough for really everything, and I will come back to them. But most of all, I really wanted to thank them for one thing. Without them, I never would have been able to follow one of my biggest passions in life, my love of stories. A story is this way that you can connect with someone on a level that a conversation really just doesn't do. It lets you understand them and see past every surface level you can possibly get through. So when you think of a story, you're probably thinking of some book in your head right now. Maybe it was a story you read for the first time when you were little, or when you're reading right now in class. But I bet what you don't think of is your own life. You don't think of the things that's happened to you, your birth, what got you to this point, or even what made you walk through this door today. And that's really what I want to talk to you about today, is that a narrative is something that each of us has. A narrative is a story, including one about life. So I first came up with this perspective of narrative back in high school in a religion class, where I started reading this book called Dead Man Walking by Sister Helen Prejean. So let me talk to you a little bit about what that story's about. So it's the story of this man, his name's Matthew Poncelet. Matthew Poncelet is on death row because he's accused of murder and rape for a young couple. It's during this time, during his last couple months on death row, that he's actually assigned a prayer partner, Sister Helen Prejean, who is actually the person that wrote the story. And at the beginning of the relationship, you see these two worlds of opposites collide. Religion versus monsters. And you see see that the two really just can't connect on any form. Matthew Ponsolet's extremely rude to her, and he tells her, you know, I do not deserve to be here. I am a free man. I'm innocent. And as the story progresses, you really see these layers of Matthew Ponsolet break away, and he becomes a lot more of a complicated character. A couple days before Matthew Ponsolet's execution, he talks to Sister Helen Prejean, and it's this moment of the most pure moment of humanity I've ever seen. And he says to her, he looks her in the eye, and he says, Sister, I am a guilty man. I did everything that I've been accused of, and there's no way I can escape my fate. And Sister Helen Prejean looks right into Matthew Ponsolet's eyes back, and she says, Matthew, I don't care about what you did. You're worth more than your worst act. And when they're putting that needle in your arm, and your eyes are closing for the last time, I want you to look at me. Because I'm a face that will love you no matter what. So when you go a few chapters later, it's the actual execution. And there's this moment where the two are looking at each other. And as Matthew Ponsolet's being strapped down into the table, he looks right to the victim's family. And he says, I am so sorry for everything that I've done to you. And I hope my death gives you some peace. The book closes after that. So reading this book, I think it's impossible for anybody to walk away feeling extremely stoic. But most people are walking away with tears in their eyes. I didn't. I walked away extremely furious. I was so mad that this moment of pure humanity, where I really saw a story and humanness really start to take form, that's where the book closed. Well, that's where my story is going to begin, because this is the moment where I decided that I am going to be a criminal justice defense attorney. So then, move forward a couple years as I got to college. And during my junior year, I had the pleasure of going to Washington, D.C. and interning in the juvenile specialty courts at the Office of the Attorney General. So this internship literally changed my life in one of the most profound ways. And one of the ways I saw this was that I really got to see the justice system in a whole new light. So the criminal justice system is where adults go. And usually, it's exactly what you anticipate. There's really three main players in every case. So you have the defense counsel, you have your prosecutors, and you have a judge. And they're all working with their own agendas. Nobody's really looking to come to a because you're there for one purpose, and that's to defend your side. Well, the juvenile justice system is a little different than that, and I was really surprised by this. So the juvenile justice system works in a more collaborative sense. Everybody comes there with their own agenda, but the main goal is to really help this child and rehabilitate this person. Because a way that you can see a case done well is when this child does not re-enter this room many years down the road. So one way I saw this specifically was the way that the Attorney General works with a perspective of rehabilitation for these kids. And one of the ways that this occurs is through what we call JBDP, or Juvenile Behavioral Diversion Program. So what this is actually a place where children can go if they've been in a bad housing situation. It's kind of like a halfway home. And they're under 24-hour surveillance, there's social workers there, and they actually get rehabilitation for things they need, like mental health or substance abuse. But what's really great about this place is that the surveillance and all of these pressure isn't to put the kid under this worst feeling of, you know, I'm a criminal, I deserve this. It's to show them that they're worth more than what they're showing themselves right now, and to show them that I know you can do better, now prove it to yourself. So I had this moment when I was talking to one of my bosses after I had experienced my semester in D.C., and I was talking to my boss from D.C., and I said, this is a fantastic system. JBDP has a success rate of almost 60 to 80% of reducing recidivism. So I asked, why are we not doing this for adults? Why is this not put in place? And the answer he gave me, and although I don't blame him for it, it really frustrated me. He said, well, you know, a child's capable of change, but I just don't know if an adult is. Let's talk about that a little bit. So to get into the juvenile justice system, you must be under the age of 17 years and 11 months. But as soon as you pass that 11 months threshold, apparently everybody in this room is incapable of change. So sorry. So, I thought about this topic, and I came to Washington, D.C. with this passion for law, because I discovered years ago that this is what I want to do. Well, now I was even more frustrated at the career that I wanted to enter into. So, returning from school, enter my thesis. And what I really wanted to do in this thesis is figure out a way to mold these two lives together. And I really wanted to see if there's a way that we can not only rehabilitate adults, but rehabilitate the most isolated adults, people on death row. So I have a couple questions that I really wanted to address in my thesis, and that's really where my story takes place. One, is it possible to rehabilitate people on death row? Two, should we even attempt to rehabilitate somebody that might be sentenced to death anyway? And three, what will happen if this works? What would happen if it means that I saw the worst person in humanity as someone equal to myself? And how does that change my perception of what it means to be human? So those are a lot of big questions to throw at you right now. So what I wanted to start with was, how did we get to this system in the first place? Why does death row exist in the form that it does right now? And death row is really built upon two pillars, the way it exists today. One is that capital punishment is said to prevent more crimes from being committed. And the other is that it's right and just that a person who has done wrong should suffer and needs to be punished in some way. So let's break those down a little bit. So what does it mean to deter crime? So obviously, if you think about your worst punishment could be that you're executed, to a rationally minded individual, that would prevent me from doing crime. But let's think about who these people are to begin with. There's been literature written upon this, not just by people on the outside, but by people that were on death row as well. And they said, if you're thinking about doing an act as irrational as killing someone, you're not going to think in terms of rational punishment. That's for the wrong type of people. So one, even with this extreme punishment form, you're not actually deterring people from committing crimes. Because if you're already thinking that irrationally, nothing's going to stop you at that point. Perhaps a little more interestingly is this very curious terminology of what is right and just. And is execution a truly right and just punishment? So Cicero has this line that says, let the punishment match the offense. And that's really when you think of death row and the proponents for it, that's the argument commonly used, an eye for an eye. So this person killed my family member, so I want to kill them. Let's talk about that line just a little bit further. So by Cicero's terminology, it's really easy to confuse that he's referring to the act of a punishment with the act of the offense. But he's not actually talking about an act here. He's actually talking about the process of natural law. So think about what it takes to become a murderer. Think about the life you must have to push you to that extent. That's not an act. That's a process leading up to this moment of a climactic decision. So what we're really doing here with the way death row is established today is we have this process of becoming a murderer, a natural progression, and we're ending it and equating it with an act of an execution that's said to be equitable to that process of your lifetime before. So what happens with this is that death row, the way that it's established today, is it's stagnating human growth. And that's really where death row syndrome comes into place and where death row really becomes complicated. So while on death row, people are not allowed to grow naturally as humans because human growth is natural, as I'll explain a little bit later. But more than that, we're really saying we want you to stay in the exact mental state that you were when you committed that crime so that we have a reason to execute you. Because if you prove that you're incapable of change, then there's nothing better we can do. So death row syndrome is this place where people begin to go insane because they're not allowed to grow as themselves. And they actually might even start to regress mentally. So in the end, because they're going to insane, a lot of them waive their rights to appeals. And really what's happening here is we're having a state-sponsored suicide rather than an actual trial with justice at the end of it. So death row, the way it exists right now, is itself self-incriminating and needs to be changed. So what can we do? What can be done? The way we really need to do this is to recognize that humans are capable of change. And this is something inherent to who we are. So let's talk a little bit about some adults that might be capable of change. There's a group in psychology known as emerging adulthood. These people are between the ages of 18 and 25, and they're psychologically predisposed to change because this is this time of huge transition in your life. You might be moving out of your parents' house, moving on to your next job, moving to college. It's this time where you're not necessarily solid at all, but you're constantly in this state of flux, and you're looking for human growth because that's the point. These are some of the people that can be impacted. But let's not just stop there. This is just one set of people that very concretely can be changed. Well, let's talk about some other ways people are capable of change to the rest of their lives, because I would argue they still are. So Erikson has this psychosocial development concept, and I'm going to explain that just a little bit in the most layman terms possible, because I'm not scientific. But basically, what he's saying here is that through your entire life, you go through these stages of growth, human development, if you will. And you start it as soon as you're born, it goes to the ages of over 65. So in infancy, you reach this crisis of trust versus mistrust. What that looks like is, okay, say I'm a crying baby. If I start crying and my mom starts coming to coddle me, I can recognize that I can trust that every time I cry, my mom's going to be there. And that way I can progress naturally into my next stage of, you know, I can be my own person because I know my mom will come back and get me. Well, let's talk about what this looks like if you are not in this stage. So say you're in the stage of young adulthood and you're facing this feeling, this crisis of isolation versus intimacy. Well, if I feel as though I'm all alone, like some people on death row might, you're not going to stay in this stage, is what Erickson said. Or actually, you're not going to progress to the next stage, is what Erickson says. He either said, one, you're going to remain at the concept of a young adult the rest of your life, or you might even regress back towards adolescence, middle childhood, and just keep going back. So it shows that this is something that is definitely can be done, and it's part of the natural human growth process. So how can we do this? If attachment is the way to get people to develop naturally, how can we do this for some of the most isolated people in society in a safe way? So this problem stumped me, definitely initially. But then I started to think back. What was it that really got me excited about this topic in the first place? What was it that changed the course of my life forever? Dead Man Walking. It's a narrative. I walked through the shoes of Matthew Poncelet and felt as though I became him. I literally have had dreams that I'm walking to my own execution. Trust me when I say I know the impact empathy can have, and I know that this is a way that you can attach with some of the people you may never meet, but that may not even exist. So my proposed solution here is that if we were to put libraries on death row, this is a way that we can have people that are the most isolated in society connect with greater humanity in a safe way. Literature has this way of letting you empathize with someone else, and it's because it's creating this sense of attachment, because you're literally walking in the shoes of someone else the whole way through. And it's through this way that people can create this false sense of attachment, but not really false. You're creating this sense of attachment with someone you don't necessarily need to be in the confines with. And this could allow for human growth and natural development along the way through death row, so that you wouldn't have these people regressing through stages, and you could actually equate then the process of growing into a criminal to the process of becoming a human again. So I know coming from an English major's perspective, this isn't the most scientific approach at all. So let me do an experiment in this room right now. One second, I'll pass out a few more of these notes. So one, I'm very appreciative that this many people showed up. That being said, I never could have anticipated this much support in me, so I'm sorry if some of you wouldn't mind sharing your note cards. So on the first side of your note card, you should see a picture of an individual, a name, and an offense. I'll let you look at that for one second. Or with a partner or something. So looking at the note card from this lens, how many of you feel that this person is deserving of a pretty decent punishment for the crime that they're committed to? Awesome. Okay. Now, do me a favor and flip that card over. On the back of that card, you should see an age, a date of execution, and something about that individual. Oh, how long they're in prison, and also something about that person. Maybe it's their last words. Maybe it's the fact that their family didn't even show up to their own execution. Look at that for one more minute. So the question I'm asking you right now isn't should this person be killed. I'm asking you, how many of you recognize that there's more to the person that's on the front side of that note card? It's moments like this that we really recognize the power of empathy, and that's what just happened. You read the narrative, and I'm not even giving you the full narrative, of someone that's on death row, and you're looking at them for just an instant on their life. And you can easily see that sense of progress that's happened, even from just this. So it may be easy for us to forgive these people, or maybe even not forgive, just attached with these people. One of the difficult questions to ask is, what about people that were affected by people on death row directly? What about victims' families? Well, this is a really difficult question to answer, and it's one that I can't give you a clear-cut solution, but I can offer some wisdom from some people far smarter than I. So in the Iliad, I'm not going to tell you the whole story, but Dr. Michael Buss could after this. So in the Iliad, there's this character named Priam. Priam has a son named Hector, and there's this other character named Achilles. So basically what happens is that Hector kills one of Achilles' friends, okay? One death, boom, directly impacts Achilles. He's so mad at Hector that he goes back and retaliates with an eye for an eye and goes back and kills Hector. So you have this direct killing of two people on each other. So Priam is Hector's father, and he has this great sense of remorse. But if we're thinking in the way of an eye for an eye approach, the logical progression of this narrative would be that then Priam would go in and kill Achilles, one of Achilles' loved ones would come in and kill Priam, this cycle would keep going on and on, right? Wrong. What happens here is that Priam goes above and beyond what it means to be a human. He goes up to Achilles, and he asks him for the body of Hector that he can have a burial. And he says these words, "I brought myself to do what no other man on earth would do. I've lifted my lips to the hand of the man who killed my son." This is an extreme moment of forgiveness and humanity that is extremely difficult to comprehend and really get to. But what's Priam really doing here? So Priam recognizes that Achilles is someone else's son. He has this extreme sense of grief for the loss of his own son and recognizes, what good would it do if I made someone else feel this exact way? When would the killing stop? And it's in this moment where the two recognize that they're both grieving people, even though they're grieving different people, that they can connect with each other and recognize that there's this unification between the two that they really need to recognize humanity from. So it's in this moment of reform that really changes the course of the narrative, because instead of Achilles, you know, remaining this isolated character like he has for a lot of the work, he rejoins humanity and begins a life. So it's, though this is just a story, we see this in Death Row as well. As we saw in Dead Man Walking, and as you saw on your note cards, this moment of execution is really the only time we see the voice of someone on death row. We see these three parties come together that are grieving in extremely different ways. We see a person that lost someone already, that is about to watch the death of a person that took away their loved one. We see the murderer's family, who is there watching the death of a loved one. And we see the murderer watching someone who he killed, their loved one, watching himself die. Crazy experience, but what's really unifying all these people is that we're all bound by the moral condition, and this can really change the way that we recognize humanity in all people. So what I'm saying here is that, yes, many people on death row can be rehabilitated, but the question I really can't answer for you is who these people are. Who are the people that can be taken off of death row and be released back into society? Who are the people that simply cannot? And that's actually the problem, and I can't even tell you the answer. Because we're not focusing any efforts in researching these people. Rehabilitation has never been attempted on death row before, and we've never even researched if it's possible. So the reason this occurs, though, is what really is the thing that's in common here, is that we're really looking for growth and unification only for moments of happiness. We're not recognizing that it's in these extreme moments of grief and sadness that humanity can truly be recognized in growth. So what would happen here? What would happen if we were able to rehabilitate these people? That's perhaps the most difficult question of all and the scariest. So let's think about that a little bit. We've never tried it before. We don't know what would happen. But if what would happen if I saw someone that was locked away, that I saw as being a monster, as having the same face as me, as having the same heart as me, and as being equal to myself? What really drives death row right at this point is because we're separating ourselves so much from the people on death row. I'm saying that I'm a good person because I'm in free society and they've done something inexcusable and need to be locked away. What we're not recognizing here is that there can be so much that can come out of this individual. We're not recognizing that humanity is in all of us and that we can help each other. If I eliminate my stigma of what it means to be a monster and recognize humanity, I can help someone grow into the human I would like to see them to be. But what's the greater cost of that is really a question we need to ask here. The media presents people on death row as being the first side of that index card, just being a face, tied to a crime, tied with being a monster. What's scary is flipping that card over and recognizing there's more to the story, because then why would we want to execute someone if I can see them as myself? Let's take this even one step further. Let's talk about terrorists. The way we present terrorists and the rhetoric used to describe them, they're completely opposite, heinous human beings who have done such a great deterrence to our country. And I'm not going to deny that. I'm not going to say that they haven't. But what we're doing in response really that better? Are we really that better from the worst people in society? Or were we all that first side of that index card? Are we all monsters? So what I'm asking you today is I'm not leaving you with this great conclusion all bow-tied. But I do have some things for you to think about. One, think about your experience here at Regis. Whether you're a student or just tied to Regis in some form, we all are taught to have this mentality of pure personalis and recognizing that people are all more than their worst acts. A criminal is not just a criminal. He's a man, a human, a mom, a dad. In the honors program, we read this book called Amy Dillard's Fourth Time Being. And she has a great quote in there that says, "The work is not yours to finish, but neither are you free to take no part in it." Regis University has opened your eyes and taught you that there's always going to be more than that first sight of the note card. I'm not asking you all to leave here today being the people that eliminate the system that created those index cards in the first place. But I am asking you this. In a world that's still staring at the front side of that note card, are you daring enough to be the first person to flip over that index card and recognize that there's more story to humanity than that? Thank you so much. There's a lot of people I really want to thank, and I would like to ask two people in particular to stand up. One's already standing. But, Dr. Narcissi and Dr. Michaelis, words really can't come to my mouth. I cannot thank you enough for like everything you've done for me at Regis, and I don't just mean this thesis. Because I told you before, this is our thesis, not my thesis. Because really everything that you've taught me has culminated into this experience. And I want to thank you for a couple things. One, you both, I feel like I've majored and minored in both of you. But not only have you cultivated my love for literature, but you've really showed me that these two seemingly opposite passions I have can come together, and you really helped me do that in this thesis. So I think of you both as friends, mentors, and second parents, so I can't thank you enough. The other people I'd like to thank, Dr. Clyer and Dr. Howe, if you both would stand up as well. In the general honors program, truly at Regis, I cannot thank you both enough for making this great program. I really felt my education has culminated, and I've met great people to have difficult conversations with, and those difficult conversations have really inspired and changed me. So thank you so much. They're not even here, but I'd really like to thank my family, even though they're not here. My family feels extremely differently than I do about death row. And what's really been helpful for me and it changed me is that it's because of the conversations I've had with them that I've gotten to the point I'm at today. I figured out my that made me walk in some shoes that I didn't want to be a part of. So I really appreciate them. Thank you, Missouri people. last but not least, I'm so humbled to be able to talk to you all. I cannot tell you how I really did not expect this many people to show up. So really that is huge. I can't thank you enough. It's a huge testament to how much Regis is really full of care. And I can't thank you all enough for being there for me every step of the way. So thank you all so much.
So we got lots of time for questions, right? So we'll start with Dr. Narcissi.
Thank you, Michaela. That was wonderful. The thesis is fantastic, too, so you should all read it. I wanted to ask you about, start by thinking about the origin of this whole project, which was that you started by thinking about how you wanted to outlaw, that you wanted the death penalty to be outlawed.
Mm-hmm.
You started there. But that was the track you took. You took a different one.
Mm-hmm.
And I wanted you to speak a little bit about how you chose where happy event, but more importantly, how you want to make the jump from where you're starting, rehabilitation, literature, empathy, into a world where the death penalty does not exist. Can you take us through that journey?
Absolutely. And you walked it with me, really. So I did not start at this thesis topic at all. If you take the first year writing seminar, you get told, pick a brick. Well, I picked a brick building, basically, and wanted to say why the death penalty was bad. Which I think I could probably go on and on about for a long time. But really what got me to this point is I started to, it was actually in Washington, D.C., I wrote a paper on death row syndrome. And I realized that there's more to the system than just killing someone. It's what's going on behind the scenes. And that's really where I got this idea of looking more at death row rather than tackling the whole system. Because I don't, that's pretty much why you got no cards today. This isn't a project one person can undertake. It's one that we all need to be a part of and really a conversation. So anyway, that's really where the process started to get more on death row. And then as you know, I was taking a psychology class actually last semester on adolescence, and we really started talking about emotional involvement. So I wanted to really just focus on how young adults on death row can be rehabilitated. So when I started writing my thesis, you know, turned in this huge draft and basically still had that thesis of the conclusion of, you know, young adults on death row should be released, or should be rehabilitated, I apologize. But my conclusion really didn't match that. My conclusion was really showing how empathy can work for anyone of any age. And you really don't, you're not tied to this time where it's got to happen right then. So that's kind of where I ended up with this broader conclusion of, you know, people on death row can be rehabilitated, and so what? Okay, so the bigger process of where I hope to take this is So next year, I'm going off to law school, and I would like to eventually become a capital punishment defense attorney. What I really want to do with that is I want to hear these stories and be a part of that. I want to walk with men and women through this process. Like, I feel like I have been through literature, but really do it on a more hands-on approach. And I think by what we can do with that is, as I get these stories, I want to culminate them into a book. I want to keep writing and really utilize those two passions and show people, I want to show people this side of humanity, because I don't think enough literature has been done on these people. And the fact that I could only find those few little words on all your index cards about each of these individuals truly shows you how little we track people on death row in their process. So what I really want to do is I want to utilize this research and show how if we can recognize these people as humans, I don't think the world will really have to do that much to really eliminate capital punishment. I think it doesn't take an extreme person to tackle this extreme problem. It makes us going back to our most human and basic form to really approach this industrial hospital. So I hope that answers your question.
You spoke eloquently about the role of narrative and its relationship to empathy. And in that culminating scene in the Iliad in book 24, that has a profound effect on us. What's interesting to me is how Priam recovers Hector's body from Achilles is through conversation. He doesn't tell a story exactly. He simply says, think of your father, Peleus. Mm-hmm. And I am far more wretched than Peleus, and he makes the argument. Right? And so what Priam does in that scene is he offers a conversational model rather than a narrative model. You might think about them as related but distinct things. And in the conversational model, he gets at something really interesting that's also empathic, which is that we can't grieve for the same thing. And that's actually, it's not despite, it's because. We're able to come together because we're grieving for two different things. You're grieving for Patroclus and Peleus, and I'm grieving for Hector. I'm wondering if you might speak a little bit about the role of conversation as you see it, either as outreach and the people in the community and turning sort of the tide toward your perspective, or within death row itself in the legal community.
Awesome. Okay, so I can answer those, but differently. So I think for people outside of death row, these conversations are really easy to have. We are, apparently, because we just have them. I think the problem is that you really need to break away from the expectation that the media is really putting on you. And I don't want to just blame the media, because I think that's very cliche. But I think a lot of it's just we need to break out of the mindset that we have right now. And I think the way we do that is by being, that's pretty much the call to action, is what I'm saying, the conclusion of this thesis is that it's by having these small conversations and actually looking into people that are isolated and really just looking into their stories. You can find any of these things online, just their final words, but you're not going to find much out about them. So I think one way that this conversation can start is that if we actually keep up to date with people on death row and go with them through the process, that's one that way that we can recognize the growth in humanity versus just saying, here's the murder they did, here was their last words. So that's greater society. For people on death row, I think it's a little trickier, because right at this point on death row, you're not allowed to talk to people on death row. You maybe get an hour in the day out of yourself, and guards really don't talk to you or anything, and you're not allowed visitors. But what I've been surprised at through my research is the amount of people that have actually written while on death row and talked about their experience in journals. And I know this isn't exactly conversation, but I think what's important about conversation is that you're putting your soul out for somebody else to hear it. And I think that's really the way you define conversation. It doesn't need to be one that's heard or, one in where somebody can respond back to you right away, but it's really just the fact of being heard in conversation. So if we're able to let these people document their experiences more on death row, one, I'm not so sure why we have to separate them from each other, but maybe these notes can be passed around, or maybe this is something that can be published, which they're just starting to do, and really let them know that their voices are being heard and that they're not alone in this process and are connected to society even when they're physically isolated. Yes?
Thank you again. I have a lot of things sort of swirling in my head, and you raise all kinds of really interesting questions and issues. So I'm not quite sure the person I want to ask, but I'll take it. So, much of what you write about your piece is sort of the whole sort of question of rehabilitation, right? And you talk about it sort of as the kind of sort of the requirement of kind of bringing about a certain thing, right? The part of the death row syndrome is that focus on sort of that maybe keep on in the future. And so, part of this, one of the things that goes on in rehabilitation is sort of looking at these people and understanding them as having a great deal of sort of tomorrow, right? getting there. But in the clip you have from Dead Man Walking, or in the sort of little snapshot you have there, right? We see Sister Helen Jean, and I'm going to say Sean Penn, but that's not
Matthew Hanson.
Right, and so there's something that happens there, right? There's some, I don't know what you want to call it, forgiveness, redemption, some kind of sort of coming together, the synthesis of the whole life, right? But what I find intriguing there, and contrasting with what you want to say about rehabilitation, is this is the moment when he precisely has no more future, right? And so what do you think about is going on there, where you know the unity sort of future, and there's something that happens there that's super significant, but it's at the moment where the future is totally off the horizon.
Well, I think what's important there is we need to really look at what is hope and what is the concept of a life well lived. A life well lived doesn't exactly mean that you have a tomorrow. Or if we discussed this in Majus, you know, even during your final moments, you have a choice to make. And how you want to proceed and look back on your life really can be determined in that time. And I think what's significant for Matthew Consulet, at least from what I've read of the story, is that he recognized that he had a life well lived because of Sister Helen Craven. And sharing his final moments with her, maybe hope isn't the right word, but that's what he needed to do. And that's the way that he could find humanity even in this inhumane situation. I know that's really not answering your question, how you inspire hope in people that kind of have no hope, if you think about it. But really the question that inspired me was, how can you give a life well lived to somebody that really doesn't have a life?
No, and I think you've got a very loose analogy with Death Row, sort of someone during hospice work, perhaps.
Yeah, exactly. Trying to find the best in any situation, really, and trying to find humanity in the final moments. Really, maybe not so much hope, but it's a way that we can move forward.
Validation.
Yeah, exactly.
I know the focus was on Death Row specifically, but how would this apply to, say, many other crimes that we have on the very far end? Let's take, for example, a very extreme example, pedophilia, rape, hardcore sexual assault crimes.
Yeah.
How would this kind of concept transfer over?
I think it transfers extremely easily. So basically the concept here is that we just want people that are isolated to be able to connect with humanity. True, I only focused on death row, but that can easily be done to people in isolation or solitary confinement, because the same really occurs there. The reason I picked death row is because there's more of a pressure, because there's more at stake at the end. And people that are in solitary confinement, even though it's super far off and really difficult to envision, you can still have that sense of a compassionate relief during their final couple months, or their case might get appealed, or you know, maybe you found out that something can be overturned. It can still work rehabilitative-wise while they're in that confinement, that this literature can connect them with greater humanity. But what's at stake is really different between the two, because one, there's a clear definitive endpoint. And though there may not seem to be a very easy one in solitary confinement or people that are in jail for life, there's still that sense of, I can have hope at the end. It's kind of what's guiding them to, there's less statistics saying that they go insane quicker than someone like that. So, if that answers your question.
First of all, great job, Michaela.
Thanks.
That's amazing.
Thank you.
My question for you is, do you think that there are people that cannot be rehabilitated? I mean, when I was watching your presentation, my mind immediately went to like serial killers, like Ted Bundy and people like that. Like, do you feel like there are some people that can't be rehabilitated, or like are somehow monsters or less human than what we would consider a normal person?
Okay. Good question. To the first part of your question, I'm going to address them separately. I do believe that there are people that we cannot let out into free society. And I'm hesitant to say that they cannot be rehabilitated, because I'm not exactly sure what that next step would be. Or, you know, maybe they can't be rehabilitated to the extent that we're all able to walk around. But is there an extent that they can be rehabilitated to maybe less of a strict prison or something like that? But yes, I do believe that there are people that, due to mental instabilities or whatever, that are just kind of not able to be let out of society for both their own good and greater society. But to your second question of, do I believe that people are monsters? I think that everyone is human. I see myself as being no different at the core as Ted Bundy. I recognize humanity. Not saying I'm better than anybody else by that. That's not what I mean here at all. But what I'm saying is, I have a really hard time calling someone else a monster when I could equally do the
So James Bigby here was a paranoid schizophrenic.
Yes.
And so I'm wondering if you would comment on, I love your idea of process to process, not act to act. Mm-hmm. I'm wondering if this is part of a larger picture of empathy for mental illness generally. And I'm wondering if you'd comment on that.
It definitely is. And that's really where death row syndrome comes into this. Because I think there's obviously this, we're less sensitive to people with mental illness because it's a disability we can't see. So people are not getting the help they need. One, because if you're probably going through the process of death row, one, you probably come from that grading background. Otherwise, you could have had that help and stability that helped you through it. But I think what's really the process I looked at was, what can be done on death row? And what about the people that are on death row getting worse? And that's actually why I picked that man, because I was so shocked that somebody with paranoid schizophrenia would be sentenced to death row. So I really can't comment on that. I'm not sure what happened there. But what I can say is that I think that there needs to be a greater awareness that people with mental instabilities don't just stop once they get on death row. It doesn't just get better. And we can't just ignore it. So I think it's a recognition of the humanity of the individual first in order to recognize that we need to care for that whole person, including their mental well-being as well, regardless of the fact that they might be executed. Because even so, it's against the law to execute somebody that's been deemed mentally insane. So if we're going to address this in light of justice, we need to address the mental capacity as well.
Yeah.
Oh,
I like the idea of process to rehabilitation. But at this point, how would you put it, do you force all inmates in death row to be rehabilitated or undergo the process of rehabilitation? Or do you offer them the choice to further their natural development? And where does that leave those who don't choose?
So from the research that I did, I found that the way rehabilitation really only works successfully is if it's a choice. So I don't think you can really force anybody. What it says about the people that are not on death row, what I don't have an answer for you, but if I were to guess, I think those might be going back to Jackie's question, maybe people can't be rehabilitated or don't want to. You can't make someone become a human again. That has to be a choice. That being said, when you're on death row for long enough, I think a good amount of people would choose that choice of at least choosing a life well lived. And maybe that's through books, or maybe that's, going to an execution center. You can't really change everybody. It has to be a choice, especially to
Because I don't know much about death row, how in your research or prior knowledge, how long of a time frame is death row?
Great question. Long. So there's really no set time, like the minimal sentence versus the max sentence, but I can tell you what I've looked up and found just from the research that I've done. So death row is an extremely long process, and that's what makes it really expensive too. And that you're going through, you can have these constant state of appeals. It's on some of your cards. You might have saw that the case was appealed about 4 hours before the execution, and then it did worse, you got executed anyway. But, so death row can go on for a long time. The youngest, or the least sentence that I saw was 7 years on death row, and that's saying when they were sentenced to death row, not when the case actually occurred. And then the longest I saw years actually on death row was 36 years. So I really don't know. It's probably a case-by-case basis, but it is definitely not less than it. Four-year process, I can promise you that.
What happens, like for the 36-year case?
Mm-hmm.
So maybe I'm in there for 12 years, and one day I decide I want to go to the library and pick up a book, and I start empathizing, and start walking around in people's shoes. And so I get this motivation back, right? Like, how much could my personal transformation be, involved in my appeal process? Or would it be that I would gain this new perspective, but I'm still stuck on death row and I still can't get out? What would be the next step for those individuals who do find a transformative experience through reading and through empathizing? Excellent question.
So I'm not sure if I exactly have a definitive answer, but the concept that I really believe is, I think it's more going to your first point, of going through the appeal process. Because if you're able to find that hope or that goodness in life, it would make you want to appeal your case more because you see that you have a life well lived. What I think is really important about the appeals process is it really is the time where you get that sense of voice for the person on death row. So So if you look up things about somebody that's on death row, the only times you hear their voice are maybe during an appeal process, if they had something different and interesting to say, before the crime occurred and at the time of their execution. So I think really what's important is that greater society is recognizing the humanity and the voice that is said during the appeal process. And if we're able to recognize this is a human that's not deserving of this punishment, we're the ones that are capable of making the change. It doesn't so much as come to the power of the individual at that point. It's a process we all need to be involved in. It can't be one person on death row.
We probably have time for one more question.
I'm wondering whether or not it's hard to disagree with something you already agree with, so I'm trying to inhabit the opposing point, but I can't, so I'm just going to agree. I'm really struck by the ways in which Cicero's natural law argument is used and misunderstood in legal communities, and that the grammar of that statement actually is it's optative, cohortative, usually let the punishment be made equal to the injury in the law, which suggests that it's our responsibility to discern what is the appropriate measure as we're balancing the offense and the injury, and whether or not the entire process is illogical and something founded on a logical fallacy, because we're equating the execution act with the murder when in fact the punishment is that larger process of withdrawal, isolation. That the execution is only a component of the larger process. So we're actually comparing in commensurate categories to begin with. And whether or not that is sufficiently geeky not to be persuasive, or maybe a point to begin a larger assault on this process. That it's not rooted in a logical process, it's rooted in an intuitive emotional belief that maybe isn't so persuasive.
I so agree with you. I don't even know how, I can't top you, that's why I'm under you and all of that. But I really appreciate it.
See, good time to say thank you.
Thank you all.
You're all invited to join us on Monday again. We'll have two more pieces on Monday. We'll continue on through April 18th.
Oh, it's Snickers. I remember. It's Snickers with one or something. Snickers. Snickers. Oh! Oh, wait.